glory. We have come to give you praise. We have come to give you glory. We have come to give you praise. You're welcome in this place. Welcome in this place. You're 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 welcome in this place. Have your way. 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 'Cause we have come to give you glory. We have come to give you praise. Place, you're welcome in this 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 place. Have your way, have your way, have your way. Soul, and let all that's within me shout out. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and let all that's within me shout out. Shout out. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and let all that's within me shout out. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Mm-hmm.
give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath.
Great are you, Lord. Is it your breath in our lungs?
Oh, the mystery across the great divide to show your love for me as you hung upon the cross and spilled your blood for me. Now I see the sin that held you there, it has no hold on me. Rose again, and now you have the victory. Forever I will sing, thank you, thank you, thank you for the cross and how I love you, Jesus. You have won my heart. This is love. This is love. My heart, this is love.
Through the eyes of men, it seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we'll step into the valley unafraid. As we call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. God of endless mercy, God of unrelenting love, rescue every door to bring us back the wayward son.
Privileged to have Bishop Beverley Mason, who is the Bishop of Warrington, and with us. I wish there were a good few more here because I'm looking forward to what you've got to say. I'm going to ask if you can, you are unmuted, there we go. And I invite you to share and read with us on Rooted in Mission.
Thank you, Phil. It's so good to be here with you. And I'm very grateful indeed for the invitation to be with you. Rooted in Mission. Some of you will know that mission and evangelism is a great passion of mine and church growth. This has been the focus of my ministry since ordination and even before then. You may know that I'm a member of the College of Evangelists. I'm on the LISIG, the Leading Your Church into Growth leadership team. It's been a great joy for me to see LISIG become embedded into the growth strategy for this diocese. But it seems to me when we set about mission, we begin with vision and strategy, don't we? I wonder how many of you, when you think mission, you think first of all of mission and strategy, what we're trying to achieve and how. We may even take this a little further, asking ourselves where and what is God doing in the world? What are the signs of God's handiwork? And in the light of this, where does God want me? What does God want me to be doing, and how? How does God want me to do this? The idea is that we are God's laborers building upon what God is already doing. Does it all sound familiar? I hope it sounds at least a little bit familiar. I think these are really great questions. They're important questions. But I'd like us to park them this evening, because I don't believe mission begins with these questions. This evening, I'm going to remind us of the essential component for mission. Without this component, there is no mission. And that component is the conversion of the heart. You know, without the conversion of the heart, and indeed our head, mission risks becoming just another task, another part of our busyness, something we do when we've got space in the diary. It may be item 2 or 22 on the PCC agenda, just depending upon your emphasis, the emphasis you place on its importance. I think all of us in a quiet, reflective moment recognize that our mission, indeed, the mission of the church, is the missio Dei, the mission of God, or at least it needs to be, for us to be effective in mission. The imago Dei cannot be separated off from the missio Dei. The two are inseparable. Sometimes we Christians endeavor to silo image from mission, and yet God can't do that. So we're braver than God. He wouldn't try. And since we are created in the imago Dei, neither should we. Mission, I believe, is properly understood as the economy of God in the world, or put another way, it's the movement of God's Holy Spirit. Mission is the Spirit breathing life into. It's what the Spirit is touching and blessing and convicting and healing. It's revealing and renewing. It's restoring and calling. It's empowering and equipping. It's sending and liberating. And if this is the mission of God, then friends, this is what our ministry should look like, isn't it? Our ministry is shaped and characterized by the imago and the missio Dei, God in us, God within us, God stirring us, and God moving us. Even for our sisters, there's no cop-out here. Even for our sisters and brothers called to the contemplative and the solitary life, they cannot escape the missio Dei. They might try, but if they're going to be faithful to their calling, they can't, because they're called to pray for the world, for the people of the world. They're called to pray for conversion, for all to come under the lordship of Christ, and pray for those tasked to labor for this. Contemplatives and solitaries have lost their focus if the desire of their heart is solely to achieve the heights of some kind of spiritual bliss and oneness with Christ through prayer. Just recently, I was reminded by a friend of some words of Jesus. "Learn from me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." I sometimes think we've made such hard work of mission. We've made an ology of it, haven't we? Mission and evangelism is for the missionaries and for the evangelists. And the thought of mission fills so many Christians with dread. Friends, that is the enemy's cunning, to do that to us, to make us impotent in terms of mission. And we can learn strategy and we can learn tactics, and I encourage that. But mission is so much more than this. For in fact, it's our natural response to the conversion of the soul. And by that I mean the conversion of the heart and the mind. Let's look at some biblical evidence for this. I'm going to draw upon perhaps some unlikely texts, but all from the Gospels. At the time of the Incarnation, the Eucharistic prayer reminds us when God, in his goodness, sent his Son, Jesus Christ, his living word, to be our Saviour. The angels declare the birth to shepherds. And the shepherds are confronted by choice. Will they go even unto Bethlehem to see this thing that has taken place? Or will they remain where they are, taking responsibility for their situation and that which they are tasked to do, which is to guard their flock? What does obedience look like in that situation? You know the story so well. They abandon the sheep and they go and see for themselves. By responding to the invitation of the angels, they go, they encounter the Christ child, they see they are blessed, and they return to their sheep. And what are they doing when they return to their sheep? They are praising and glorifying God. We often lose that because we're so quick to get to the next part of the story. There's a new song in their heart and on their lips. I remember some years back celebrating Holy Communion in what's known as the Shepherd's Cave in Bethlehem, where our guide, a Palestinian Christian, said with solemnity and gratitude, "We trace our faith back to the shepherds." That's quite a legacy, isn't it? We trace our faith back to the shepherds. That's how seriously Palestinian Christians take the whole story of the Incarnation. When Jesus was just a baby, he's taken into the temple to be dedicated. And there's a woman there who's advanced in years. She's been faithfully living and serving God in the temple. She's been praying and fasting, and she encounters him. And in the seeing comes the knowing. He is the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And the woman, Anna, full of joy, praises God. I have a feeling she's the first charismatic in the New Testament. And she tells of the child to all who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem, the holy city. Can you imagine what she was saying? He's coming. Don't give up. Don't despair. He's coming. He's coming. I've seen him. He's coming. Can you hear it? There's resonance, I believe, here, if you look for it, with the Samaritan woman, whom Jesus, you'll recall, encounters at the well. When she arrives at the well, the woman sees no more than a man and a Jew, and she'd have felt hostility. Why was he lingering there by himself on her patch? All she wanted was water. Yet Jesus tears down walls of hostility. He sees her. And what does he see? He sees a daughter of Abraham. She's a child of God, and she, like every child of God, has need of living water that only he can offer. He speaks with her as one to another without superiority, without disdain. He doesn't say, "Do you know how important I am?" He doesn't pull his weight. He doesn't play a power game with her. He meets her where she is. And yet he is the King of Kings. The woman is so blessed by the encounter. We see her conversion, the conversion of her soul. She races back to the town. She's full of joy and she's praising God and she tells everybody. She can't be silenced. And others are brought to Jesus through her with a new song in her heart. She cannot be silenced. We see something similar as Jesus fulfills the prophecy of Zechariah in Zechariah 9, chapter 9. Riding into the holy city as the Messiah, you'll recall, the Pharisees come out to him. They have good reason to. There's a story here. They come out to him and they demand that he silences the praises and the anthems of the people. Hear his words to them. If I were to silence them, the very song, the very stones would burst out in song. The Pharisees were unable to see what the people were seeing. Their hearts were closed to offer, the offer Jesus was making to them, and therefore they were unable to sing the new song of praise and blessing. Just recently, during this time of lockdown, I heard of a woman whose daughter was diagnosed with COVID-19. The woman was very, very frightened for her daughter. She was in lockdown herself. She couldn't see her daughter. She had no access to her. And she was helpless. There was nothing she could do. She was crying out, but there was no one to hear her. What can I do? What can I do? In the window opposite her, there was a rainbow. Have you noticed how wherever God is, there's a rainbow around his presence? Have you noticed that? On this poster were the words, "Put your trust in Jesus." And on the poster next to this poster was another one which read, "Pray to Jesus. Ask Jesus." Here was a woman saying, "What can I do?" And she was being given an answer in the window opposite her. The woman prayed, and she prayed like never before. And her daughter did recover. And the woman couldn't be silenced. With little regard for lockdown and distancing, she went out into the streets and she rejoiced and she praised God and she told everyone she met what God had done for her. The conversion of the soul is made of 1,000,000 conversions. And with each conversion comes the song of rejoicing and thankfulness and praising and glorifying of God. And friends, this is the song of conversion. And it's conversionary. Have you noticed how profligate Jesus is in blessing? He scatters blessings like seeds, praying that they will take root. And his desire is for us to do likewise, beginning first of all with ourselves, with you and me. It's amazing to be part of the big missional platform, to be working for the conversion of the masses. But we do set ourselves a mighty task. And it may just be that the burden and the yoke isn't sufficiently light and agile for this. Jesus invites us to be who we are, not anyone else, to embrace the blessings that he's pouring out onto us, for us to respond with joy and thankfulness, with the song of blessing that will reach out and bless others. In Mark's Gospel, in chapter 10, verse 46 to 52, it would have been very easy to forgive anyone crowded in by people, not seeing a man in the dust by a city gate and begging. Jesus is crowded in, yet he sees, yet he hears. When his followers try to silence the man and forbid him from pressing on the master's time or mission, Jesus corrects them. This isn't the first time he does this, is it? He intervenes, he stops, and he says, "Call him here." The disciples say to the blind man, "Take heart, get up. He's calling you. When our mission becomes too task-focused, is there space to see the person beyond the crowd? The person whom God can see, but who has become blocked out to us? Is there space to hear the child of God crying out, Son of David, have mercy on me? Friends, you know this as well as I. There are so many lost, disoriented, careless, indifferent, chasers of false gods and fragile hope. Those who have chosen not to see. Those who have refused the invitation. Those who have never knowingly come into the presence of Jesus. Those who are crying out in despair, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me, a sinner. People are crying out all the time. And I wonder and I fear that the church is too busy to hear and to see. And I wonder if we really make space for the people God is wanting us to come alongside in all of our vision and strategy. Come back to the conversion of the heart and the new song that God gave you. And let your mission burst forth from that song. As lockdown lifts, and as we go out into the world anew, may every day bring missional encounters. May each of us, you and me, minister from the riches of our joy, our praises, our love, and our thankfulness. For that's where authentic mission sits. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
I'm mindful, I haven't given you a reading, but I've given you texts. And so what I'm going to do is jot these texts down in the chat room for you. So if you want to take a look at them, you can. But if this springboards into other conversations and takes you into different directions, that's absolutely fine. So long as you're asking the question, who is it God wants you to be speaking to? Who is it he's wanting you to see and to bless? Who in the street? Who when you're walking the dog? Who when you're in the long queue for the shops? Who is he wanting you to see and hear and bless? Amen.
Thank you. I'm going to play another song, and then I'm going to ask people if they don't mind going into breakout rooms. There's actually 26 of us here tonight, and we've got four breakout rooms. I've asked Martin, Sandra, Hillary, and Sam to actually just chair those groups, but just to have an opportunity to talk and reflect on some things that Bishop Beverley said, and also to excuse me, and also maybe to pray for each other. But before we do so, there's a song, There Is a Day. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to open the rooms now, and hopefully you'll all be invited to join us there. So how were the breakout rooms? Were they okay?
Very nice.
Good.
Yes, it was good.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, I want to thank, just take the quick opportunity to thank Bishop Beverley for coming. Thank you so much for being prepared to talk to us via Zoom. I know you do, and half your life is on a Zoom phone call. I know I've picked up recently, so thank you for being here.
Well, it's been really good being with you. What I do want to clarify is that what I'm not saying, and I want to just reiterate this, I'm not saying vision strategy is bad and it's nice. But don't you dare go home with that. Don't you dare. Don't you dare say that. is down the pan, will you?
Yes.
Or I won't forgive you. I'll withhold the blessing. But it starts with conversion, doesn't it?
Mm.
Keep coming back to the new song.
Thank you so much for speaking. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Our lowest number tonight, we've had 24 screens with 26 people, which for the middle of July and the pandemic lifting is not too bad. But I'm hoping when this is all over, we'll invite you again to actually come and speak to real people in a real place. And you can bring real earplugs as well.
And the dog.
And the dog.
That's very fun.
So it's really come for that. Oh, <it's>
right on cue.
Right, that's perfect, isn't it? We're not. We don't know if there's going to be a Rooted in August. We're not sure yet. So, but we'll let you know if there's going to be. If it is, it'll be on the same Zoom codes as this one. But for the moment, I'm not expecting there to be any more. I think it's time for a final prayer. And actually, because I've got a bishop and I'm totally outranked in every possible way, I'm going to ask, would you be so kind as to close in prayer?
Lift one.
My reason. Yeah,
let's pray. Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit. Please touch us with your Spirit. And in the touching, we pray that you will open again the eye of faith, that we may see a little more and a little deeper and keener. And in the touching, may we hear a little clearer. And in the touching, may we know a little bit more. A little bit more of the mystery of your extraordinary love for us, the amazing blessing you've brought us under, the divine mercy that is ours in you. May the touching remind us of the healing and the restoring, the renewing, the making clean. May the touching stir up hope within us, allaying all fear, casting out anxieties. May that touching penetrate the very deepest places of our heart. And may it grow within us an even greater capacity to love. We pray, Lord Jesus, come and remain enthroned within us, where we may serve you and love you, where we can know you more clearly and love you more dearly. Give to each of us that song of thankfulness, the spirit of joy, and the words of blessing. Tomorrow, may we find three people at least to bless. And on Tuesday, may we find three more. And Wednesday, may we find three more. And for those you send our way, may we bless and bring them one step closer into the expansive love and mercy of your grace. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those you love and for whom you pray this day and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for coming. And I hope you have a pleasant evening. God bless everybody.